Good evening and welcome to Inside Your District. My name is Marcia Goodman-Hinnershitz, City Councilor for District 2 in the City of Reading. And I have a guest this evening, a longtime resident of District 2, Bill Vitale. And Bill and I have been involved for decades, probably, when you look at it, as far as looking at how we can really make the City of Reading the best that it can be. And tonight's topic, we're going to be talking about sustainability. We're going to define what sustainability is, talk about it from the higher level, and then look at what's happening locally. So, Bill, welcome this evening. Okay, and I guess the first question is, I think for our home viewers, sustainability is a word that some people may not have a clue about, but other people have been very actively involved with. Mm-hmm. So could you just give us a snapshot what sustainability means?
Well, it means a lot of things. In some ways it means different things to different people. Mm-hmm. That's part of the problem. But there is an actual definition of sustainability that's used in sort of the green building and sustainability mm-hmm. movement. I'm going to paraphrase it somewhat, but it's basically doing things now that do not jeopardize the future for future generations. So, mm-hmm. you know, when we talk about whether it has to do with health or climate, you know, water supply is a good example. Mm-hmm. You know, making sure that the water supply is there and mm-hmm. and healthy mm-hmm. for future generations, not doing something now that's going to destroy that. So. That's the basic concept of sustainability in terms of a very specific definition, but it does mean different things to different people, and it's one of the challenges when you're kind of using it, the term.
Yeah, and as we have our discussion about more specific examples, I'm going to then reference back to what I needed to do on City Council and what our fellow council members did to make mm-hmm. decisions that really embrace sustainability. Mm-hmm. And we're going to be talking about the STAR program, how Reading got involved in that, you know, what the components are, and how we're going to be moving forward to make sure mm-hmm. that that's continued. But so maybe just talk about what your involvement's been with sustainability, because you've been a real proponent of it, a real active advocate.
Well, I was really going back to the early 70s. It's something that I have been interested in. It started with an interest. I was an architect. I'm retired. But I was interested in green building and building sustainably, particularly centered around solar. And mm-hmm. so I started designing passive solar homes in the 70s. And then it kind of grew from there. And I guess I could call myself an environmentalist. So I've been concerned with the broad range of issues that have to do with sustainability. Mm-hmm. And then professionally, and in terms of what's been happening in this country around the world, something called the LEED rating system right. was developed, I'm going to try and remember dates here, somewhere in the late 90s, I guess. Mm-hmm. And that started to emerge as a tool for designing buildings that met the different aspects of sustainability. And for me, it was even a learning process, because I think my understanding of what it meant to be sustainable broadened. And in fact, LEED, I know this isn't your question, but LEED, the LEED building or rating system basically focuses on five categories. The sustainable sites, which has to do with stormwater runoff and mm-hmm. the use of land and that kind of thing, water efficiency, energy and atmosphere, which is mostly how a building performs, materials and resources, which has to do with healthy materials, materials that aren't a tax on the environment and the production or aren't toxic in their disposal, that kind of thing, the indoor environmental air quality, mm-hmm. which was something that I didn't give a lot of attention to in the early years, but as we started to develop more efficient and airtight buildings, it got to be a very important aspect.
Yeah, and I want to make a comment about that, and this is just from personal experience.
Sure.
I've worked in buildings that are, you cannot open the windows.
Yeah.
What I've noticed with those buildings is people get sicker in them.
Yeah, sure.
They're like sick buildings because you're not getting the air circulation you need, mold grows, and people don't even think about that.
Yeah.
But when I was able to move to another environment, my health improved.
Well, you know, there's another aspect to that. It's not only allowing fresh air, Unfortunately, a lot of the mechanical systems that were designed and still being designed they're actually toxic in their function, mm-hmm. and not enough fresh air is used or introduced into the system. Mm-hmm. So really, every LEED building, some of the guidelines have to do with the quality of the indoor air. I mean, you don't get points. Mm-hmm. You can't. I mean, I think you couldn't even get a basic certification if you didn't have that. And so what was some of the things that they found, since we're talking about indoor air quality, is that people's productivity, their alertness, mm-hmm. all of these things. I don't know if you've gone to a meeting at the Community Foundation.
Oh, definitely, yeah.
I noticed that shortly after that building opened, we'd be sitting in there. Usually 45 minutes into a meeting, you're kind of accustomed to sort of feeling like you're dragging because you just think like, oh, it's because the meeting is boring. It's really because the air, the quality of the air and the level of oxygen and the combination of using fresh air so that there's good air to breathe. A lot of the older systems and systems that aren't designed according to those guidelines, that's what happens.
But the Community Foundation's building is designed.
The Community Foundation was the first LEED building in the city of Reading. It's a LEED Platinum building. Mm-hmm. That mechanical system, that's basically the indoor air quality, is part of the mechanical system, was specifically designed to have healthy indoor air.
And I have to say something, and it's sort of off topic a little bit, but I think it's interesting. The casinos actually design their systems to put more oxygen in the air.
So you feel more elevated, yeah.
Yeah, so the people feel more elevated, and they keep their gamblers awake. And they know how to do that.
So they know, exactly.
They know how important that is, but not maybe for the reason we would want it to be, but for any of you that go down to the casinos, you might find that the air quality is a little different in there than it might be in a regular building.
So indoor health, the quality of the air is one of the pieces of LEED building. And when we get to talk about STAR is kind of the concept of LEED exploded to the community level.
So why would a community need to be focused on these kind of issues? How important is that for people that live in the city of Reading as far as putting that on their radar screen? Why,
Well, it has to do with health.
Okay.
It has to do with sustainability of the planet.
Right.
Which matters to all of us. Mm-hmm. Because climate, our impacts on the climate, what we've come to know now as climate change, mm-hmm. is affected by carbon emissions. Mm-hmm. And buildings are a major contributor to carbon emissions, as are automobiles, as are industrial processes. All those things have a dimension that where if they are designed and set up in the right way, they can reduce carbon emission or eliminate it altogether. Mm-hmm. And healthy buildings, green buildings, do that. The LEED buildings in Reading, I don't know how many there are, there's somewhere around maybe a half dozen, maybe more. Mm-hmm. My firm was involved in three of those, and tangentially in a fourth one, but I'm going to venture to guess that the other ones function in the same way. They all are, their contribution to the carbon footprint is much lower. Now, it doesn't have to be a new building. Each one of us in our own residences, doesn't matter if we rent an apartment, if we own a home, mm-hmm. If we don't live in the city but we have a business in the city, if we function in some way, if we live or work or play in a building or own a building, we have opportunities to do things that can work to the benefit of the environment. That's just in terms of climate. I mean, there are many other aspects. So we talked about two things now. We talked about health, we talked about climate. Mm-hmm. There are other aspects to why we should be concerned. I don't know if you want me to go on to the other ones, if you want to ask another question.
Well, I think we maybe want to focus on the STAR program and what STAR is.
Yeah,
I believe we have a logo, if we can bring it up.
The cover of the manual.
And Reading is STAR certified. So, first of all, let's say, what does STAR stand for?
Okay, STAR is an acronym for, convenient acronym for, give me a second, it is... Just looked at it, and I'm going to find out which page it's on, because it's a mouthful. Maybe while we talk about it, I can find... it is a community rating system Mm-hmm. And STAR is an acronym. Can't do this in a half hour. I just had it in front of me.
Well, why don't we just talk about what the components
are?
Yeah,
I'll find it at some point.
Yeah.
Yeah, if I could do the STAR is a it is a rating system that looks at a community in 8 different categories, mm-hmm. and then each of those categories are broken down to 6 or 7 parts, 4 to 7 parts, and then each one of those you evaluate the community according to certain benchmarks.
Mm-hmm.
And the 8 categories, and I think I should just run through them and read
sure.
them off, because I think that's a way of answering your early question, is what should we be thinking about in a place like Reading? The first is the built environment, and we can come back to the subheadings. The second is climate and energy, which really addresses what I was just talking about. The third is economy and jobs. So there's a social economic component to this also. It's not just what people would be, you know, would criticize us as tree huggers.
Yeah.
It's beyond that, because that's part of sustaining a community, mm-hmm. right? Education, arts, and community, mm-hmm. that has an economic dimension, but it also has a social, cultural dimension, part of the richness of living a life in a community. Equity and empowerment,
mm-hmm.
That's the fifth category. Health and safety, mm-hmm. so more than just health, has to do with safety. Natural systems, that's things like green infrastructure, invasive species, and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then the eighth category has to do with innovation and process. So you get points for being innovative and coming up with new things, or in process, if your level of engagement of different parts of the community mm-hmm. Is really high, you get points for that.
And I want to say, as decision makers on City Council, and I know Councilman Twyman was very much involved
yes,
in the STAR
was.
Process,
mm-hmm.
you know, I did some contributions as far as health and human services, things that we needed to look at. But as we got our STAR certification, and we can talk about how Reading was ranked, we also want to move forward and make sure that that continues, because we don't want to lose the momentum that we've gained. And we
right.
make decisions right. sometimes looking at all those issues. For instance, an example would be our steep slope ordinance, which talks about what can be built mm-hmm. on what terrain mm-hmm. in Reading.
Right.
Our decisions regarding our shade tree commission and what happens to the trees in the city, okay, because we have an urban forest. We all make decisions that people may not think about as being important, but they all contribute to the sustainability. And even as you said earlier, decisions we make about our economy, about jobs, all those things really help to support Reading. So even our decisions about Act 47 and getting ourselves out of a distressed city have to do with sustainability.
They do. And you know, Reading has a history of doing things, and that some things come to mind. The socialist administrations, one of the things they did was, when instead of building a new city hall, mm-hmm. they took over the former Boys High School
uh-huh.
when that moved up to Reading High.
Uh-huh.
They took an existing building and renovated it. That was a very sustainable move, because you don't need as much resources to renovate a building as it takes to build one. The other thing is that they, if I remember my history of the community correctly, they're the ones who took the steps to make Mount Penn preservation land.
Mm-hmm.
And talk about sustainability. I mean, we have a wooded mountainside right at our, you know, I mean, virtually at our doorstep. You know, I can walk 5 minutes from my house and I'm in trails.
And I'm on the other side of the mountain.
Yes, exactly. And you get to look at it, you know,
yeah.
or walk a few blocks. But even the activities of Center Park Historic District, going back now at least 20, maybe close to 25 years now, and maybe they've had their 25th anniversary. That's an active group in a neighborhood that has worked very hard to preserve the historic character. That's part of sustainability on many, many levels. I mean, it can tick off maybe 3 or 4 of these categories, the value to a community of historic preservation.
And I think a real important piece that's happened within this past year is the formation of the Mount Penn Preserve,
yes.
which is inter-municipalities,
yes. yep.
and coming forward now, I know the county commissioners introduced it today, it's called the Council of Governments, where we're going to be looking at the municipalities of Reading, Mount Penn, Lower Alsace, and Alsace, all coming into a collaborative agreement about how we contribute to preserving the Mount Penn area, which includes, you know, part of Neversink and such.
That's really positive.
I mean, this is, and I'll send you a copy of what that agreement's going to be looking
that's
like.
Great.
But we've worked over the years, or over the past year, and hopefully all the governments will be passing that, and then we'll be looking at things that we can do. A good example is how we really protect Skyline Drive and all the areas around the mountain. We have bike trails up there now. We want to make sure that that's used to the best use of the public. And I know if we go for a star rating, that will probably have play a large role in helping us to get major points.
Well, I don't know when that the improvements along Skyline were finished, but the first time I went up, a couple things. I was impressed, and I felt very proud of my city. You know, the double lanes along the left side, the really nice trail, although I'm not quite sure what happened, how you ride a bike there in the winter with all the acorns and stuff fall down.
But
that's a separate question. But, you know, the logos, the way it's marked, and I've ridden up there a couple of times, I discovered that Skyline is not level.
Oh, yeah.
When you drive it, it seems like it's pretty level, but when you ride a bike on it, you discover that it's far from it. But and Rose, my wife and I have walked up there a few times. It's really, really pleasant. And I don't know what funds were used to accomplish that.
Actually, state funds, but it was a collaborative agreement between the municipalities involved
that
could happen.
Just Reading. Uh-huh.
And so we have done things in the background that people aren't aware of until they make use of it. The way that we're repaving the streets is another way we're trying to make the city safer.
Yes.
What we have to do with our urban forests, cutting down some of the trees because they're diseased, but making a commitment to replanting them. And one of the discussion items that's going to come up in the very near future is in the past, the trees have been the responsibility of the homeowners. And we know not all homeowners have the capacity, the resources to be able to take care of the trees. So we're looking at what can the city do to make that happen.
Yeah.
So they're all important things that really contribute to the health of the city.
They do. And the health, again, that's health on many levels. It's in fact healthier, and it's healthier for the environment because trees do reduce the carbon footprint, as well as directly, as well as indirectly, they keep the surface area cooler. Cars parked underneath are cooler, so you don't need, it reduces a little bit how much air conditioning you need to pump into a car to cool it off in the summertime. I mean, trees are just, talk about a win-win situation.
Now, I have an important...
But they do require maintenance, it's true.
We're getting into a real good discussion. I'm looking at, we don't have that much time left.
So,
and I'm wondering, I have to ask our people that are operating, can we go on for another half an hour? Is that possible? Okay, that is. Let's do that then, Bill, because I think that we're not going to really cover the topic because we just really got started on it as far as the components of the STAR.
Sure.
So
I hope I don't run out of things to say.
No, because there's some other things we need to talk about practical application once we go through it as far as things that are happening in the city, talking about the bicycling and everything like that. So real important stuff.
Well, maybe since we were talking about the bikeway up on Skyline, and I had a couple of thoughts, and maybe that can segue into some other discussions.
Okay.
My hunch is that having that improved lanes up there encourages use. I mean, I rode there because I felt safe riding there.
Right.
I'm a man in my 70s. I would imagine that once people understand that it's there, and it's beautiful. I mean, it's just great. You're riding up, and you're looking down over. On the top of Mount Penn, you look out over the city, out toward South Mountain. It is just a gorgeous place to ride a bike, and because of the improvements, it feels safe and you feel protected. And I think, likewise, if there are bike lanes, and I know this came up in discussion a couple of weeks ago, it was in the paper that I guess the Redevelopment Authority is proposing bike lanes as part of a plan. And there was some discussion as to whether people ride bikes here. I'm convinced that if, and this applies to me again, I'm reluctant to ride my bike. I go to meetings downtown or to the Goggle Works. I'm nervous about getting on the city on those streets like Washington or Walnut or whatever. But if there were bike lanes on one of those main streets, I would use it. I have a feeling more people would, and so the more people that use bikes, the more other people are encouraged to use bikes, because then you start to be a place where people feel safe riding bikes, and they understand that people do that. And so it has, that has a dimension in terms of sustainability, because the carbon footprint of a bike rider, I guess it's zero.
And we are talking about things like complete streets, which includes right. the idea of bike lanes.
Exactly.
What the I don't
exactly.
believe the proposal that was put out about a month ago is going to move forward, that particular proposal, but
right.
it doesn't mean we still can't have discussions.
Right. Right.
And with the commitment of all the people that are involved in bicycling, with the city's commitment to the Radsport effort, and that bike race will be happening, I believe, then they're in the planning stages to bring it back next year. What that's done is gotten a lot of folks interested in biking, but what I've seen is not everyone is knowledgeable about how you bike in a city which
right.
doesn't have designated bike lanes at this point,
mm-hmm.
how you do
mm-hmm.
that safely,
right.
but that
right.
it is an ideal method of transportation. Because on the other hand, we're struggling about what to do with all the cars.
Yeah.
And we're running
right.
out of parking spaces
right.
in the
right.
city, because everyone has one, two, three cars. And they just physically, I always said it's almost like playing musical chairs, where the last person doesn't get a chair, the last person doesn't get a parking space. And I've come home many a times that I don't, even though I don't have houses across the street from me, I still don't find parking. Okay,
mm-hmm.
so that we have to really look at, are there other ways of moving around through a city that doesn't require that, and how do bicycles fit in?
Well, bikes as a mode of transport in a city are just in some ways ideal.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, with Reading, there's a little bit of a problem because there are parts of the city that are fairly hilly, but with the gearing on bikes now, and
mm-hmm.
if you're young, it's kind of a non-issue. But when I was younger, I did ride, I would ride to business meetings
mm-hmm.
On occasion.
Mm-hmm.
And we lived in New York for a time, and I rode to work every day on my bike. It was just like it was just the ideal way to get there, the right amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, New York, even at that time, there were no bike lanes, but people were just more familiar with people on bikes because there's just a lot of bike. And you know, I was young and kind of stupid about it, but.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, as you get older, you begin to see all the bad things that can happen.
Right, but we have bike racks in front of the DoubleTree, so you see people that, you know, so there's a real reinforcement.
People use them, right?
Yeah.
You see bikes there? Yeah.
Yeah, there are people that I know that do still bicycle to work. Where I work, you know, in the Santander Bank building, you see people bicycling to work, so that it is started, but we need to be able to look at where is the best place to put the bike lanes. Where's the safest place to have them? And then also to be encouraging our young people to learn how to bike safely. And I know we
right.
have, there was an article in the Reading Eagle today about
yeah.
the status of the Reading Bike Hub and that might be endangered. And those folks that ran that, and they were on a show with me one time, really have done a lot to educate youth and to be able to make a commitment to safe biking.
Yeah.
So we have to make sure that in some way what the efforts are that they've done can be sustained too.
Yeah, I was disappointed to see that today. I was peripherally involved in the setting of that up, followed it. I, you know, was there on occasion in the first several months
mm-hmm.
and watched the Wednesday afternoon bike rides that,
mm-hmm.
that originated from there. And, you know, there was sometimes up to 45 kids
mm-hmm.
out riding up and down the streets. You know, it's a little safer. It was in the summer and later in the afternoon or early
mm-hmm.
evening, so
mm-hmm.
there wasn't as much traffic. But, you know, we discussed earlier, Dave Klein was part of that, and there were
mm-hmm.
a few other adults, but mostly it was kids from the city.
Mm-hmm.
And as the article said today, the kids use that as a kind of a recreation center. They go there, and it'll be a shame for them if that folds. And so I'm hoping that some entity will step forward to find the resources to keep that going. I forget the person's name, but the person who volunteers there.
Jason North.
Yeah, he gave every indication that he's willing to stay with it. So.
Yeah, and I'm looking at the fact that, I serve on the Reading Recreation Commission, which is a collaboration between the Reading School District and the City of Reading, and looking at other types of activities for young people. And the fact that the Recreation Commission is a major partner in the bike races, I think we may need to look at how that fits in
mm-hmm.
with the mission of the
mm-hmm.
Recreation Commission, how we can make biking something that the young people, whether you have bike rodeos, you know, different kinds of activities. But the message is that we don't need to be dependent on cars. And I always thought it was sort of silly when I think about it, that that I need to take a, I don't know how big cars are, a couple tons, yeah, kind of vehicle, get in there by myself and drive that into work,
yeah,
and have that vehicle sit there all day.
Right.
What that doesn't, yeah, make any sense,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So as the weather starts breaking, you know, I will either walk into work, which is walkable. People think, well, but it only takes me like a half an hour to walk into work, or if the weather's bad, take the bus in.
You know, I don't know if you're aware, there was a car sharing initiative, mm, that came very close to getting off the ground. Mm. It was going to involve City Hall, mm, I think the Parking Authority, Albright, mm, Alvernia, maybe the Reading Hospital. Mm. John Kramer, with a nonprofit organization, New Communities, mm, Community Development Corporation. It didn't happen because the entity that was going, we were partnering with, mm-hmm, in Philadelphia imploded.
Oh, okay.
Otherwise, it would have happened. But that's a case where you could take a bus to work, mm-hmm, or walk to work, and then if you needed a car, mm-hmm, to go somewhere, if let's say a city employee does, they could use one of the car sharing cars rather, mm-hmm, than having to bring their own car. Now, or you know, I guess city employees have vehicles, but.
Not all of them, but
yeah. No, it was a good. It would have been a great plan, and mm-hmm, it was just about ready to get off the ground. And this goes back maybe about 10 years now, and it was looked at as part of the whole process that led to doing the star rating system too as a possibility. There were many things on the. There were many sustainable initiatives on the table being explored, mm-hmm, by the Spencer administration.
Yeah. And one of the things I want to say about that is I am very cautious about labeling it being part of any one person, that it really has to be something that's shared by the community, mm-hmm, because, mm-hmm, then what happens is people change and go away, so you need,
right,
to be able to really,
absolutely,
establish it as being, that's part of sustainability.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't belong to one person.
No.
And I,
right,
people can tell when someone labels something according to an elected official. I don't have the Goodman-Hinnershitz initiatives.
Yeah, yeah.
They are initiatives that are good for the community.
Yeah,
they don't,
yeah,
need to be connected,
yeah,
with my name.
Yeah.
Okay? I feel that that's sort of very self-serving.
Yeah.
So, you know, I've done a lot of things that I believe are important, and luckily I came from a background where my family had that all about how we lived and such. And so, like, for instance, preserving Antietam Lake, getting involved with the Mount Penn Preserve, you know, getting involved in the Reading Recreation Commission, but it's not only about me, it's about, mm-hmm, all the people that we can bring together, mm-hmm, that, yeah, are going to share those values. And that's why I respect you, Bill, because you've always been behind all these to be able to keep, you know, fighting the good fight. So,
well, it's true. I mean, it does take sustained involvement in it, and it doesn't, it, and you're absolutely right. It can't survive or fail based on the change of administration. And we've seen that often happen in mm-hmm, groups too, that are, you know, mm-hmm, volunteer groups. You have a committed, passionate leader of the group, and mm-hmm, something happens, and then when that leader decides to move on or dies or whatever, mm-hmm, the initiative ends. And that's so building in sustainability in that regard is absolutely part of it. Yep.
Yeah. And so I think we haven't really gotten into the weeds as far as talking about you know, the whole thing, pieces about the STAR program. So where do you want to go next as far as the different components?
Well, you know, maybe to pull out some examples. What I should maybe just come back to how the process works.
Okay.
Okay. So in the meantime, I should have found what it stood for.
STAR
is administered by a nonprofit organization at the national level. And similar to LEAD, it's an iterative process. So, you know, a general idea was put together, and then it was put out into communities, elected officials, economists, experts of all kind, to get feedback, mm-hmm, and then it was refined, and then it was piloted in a couple of communities, and based on that experience, it was refined yet again,
mm-hmm,
and so it's a continual process of renewal that is part of it, so that it's not like set in stone, and then from then on, that's what it is. You know, it's an ever changing system. This actually, in fact, is from 2000, 2014. So this is probably an out-of-date manual. The page that was shown on the screen is the rating system that was used by the folks involved in Reading to, and here's what it stands for, staring me in the face, this was what was used to go through the process, and I'm going to just digress for a second. So STAR Community stands for Sustainability Tools for Assessing and Rating Communities.
Okay.
So as I said, it acts as a benchmark. So part of the process is assessing where the community was, and then the community is rated. The idea being that after a 3 to 5 year period, you improve on that rating. So the process of getting the rating, I'm not sure how many months, it may be about 6 months or a year. There were dozens of people involved. As you said, you were involved, not as a member of council necessarily, but as part of COCA, I guess, or maybe in both capacities.
Well, I think as a social worker, I was, you know, interviewed, I believe, by Brian Kelly, and I said, okay, these are some of the components that I'm aware of that exist within the community. For instance, we were doing a Healthy Corner Store program that was actually out of the Department of Health, where we were trying to have stores carry healthy produce. So rather than just having the disposable foods, that they would have fresh vegetables. And there's actually a program, and I'm thinking it's still being operated at this point, that we're trying to get the local bodegas to make sure that they sell fresh fruit. Now, what I've been impressed by when I go into a lot of these stores, you can tell they've invested in it because, for instance, you go into Jimmy's Market, I think they have some of the best produce.
You mean down South Ninth?
Yeah. I mean, it's amazing the produce they have down there and fresh food. So it's a matter of looking at how we want to eat healthy. And so, again, I think all of us might have different information that we're aware of that can contribute to this STAR process.
Well, that is part of the... I don't want to use the word exciting, but the valuable aspect, let's say the valuable, one of the valuable aspects of STAR is it takes these what seem to be disparate things that really are all connected with making a community a viable place to live and helping the planetary issues like climate. And so it was at the outset, it's a process of going out in the community, looking for the things that are already being done and measuring them. So that first round, we got a 3-star rating out of a 5-star system, and nothing was done, and in terms of changing anything, it was really just collecting data and information about things like this program you just mentioned, the LEED buildings that had been done to that point. These were things that were done either by the public sector or the private sector or the nonprofit sector. So that's part of it. It's that analysis of what's there. Another piece then is taking all that and putting it in a comprehensive framework so people in the community who think this matters can see how all this fits together, and get a sense of a sort of comprehensive approach. Then, with that, you can identify the holes. You can identify the weaknesses. You can identify the places that effort and expenditures need to be made. Again, either by the public sector, the private sector, or the nonprofit sector, or a combination of two or three of those. So that in a sense is the general value or the general aspect of STAR within which these different categories are looked at. And you know, we could spend a 4-hour program going into the weeds, as you said, but maybe it would make some sense to pull some of these out and kind of describe what they say.
And then maybe give examples of what we have in existence in Reading that meet those criteria.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, one, for instance, on a built environment, compact and complete communities. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, anybody who is familiar with Reading, you know that that's going to be, we're going to get something for that because we're a compact community, which makes it walkable. I mean, you know, that's one of the reasons why we can talk about bike riding or people walking to work or public transit because of the density of Reading.
Right.
As opposed to You know, what example am I going to get without offending someone? I mean, you take one of the rural municipalities, a public transit system is really doesn't make a lot of sense. If somebody works, you know, 15 miles away from where they live, it's going to be very hard for them to walk to work or to a restaurant that's 10 miles
away. Okay, give you an example. We have payments in the city, which make them walkable because you don't need to walk out in the streets. You go into some of our suburban communities,
right,
payments aren't required.
Yep.
Okay, so people basically don't have a safe place to walk. The building, we have huge parking lots, and the buildings are structured around making sure that there's a lot of parking rather than making it walkable.
Right. So. That's right. Yeah. And that's the way the city developed. Mm-hmm. And that is one of the key aspects of why cities are inherently sustainable, because they've sort of started on the 10-yard line or the 20-yard line in a 100-yard dash.
So we've started out with an advantage as far as some things that are already structured.
Now, okay. I wasn't able to locate. Oh, I know why. I don't have it printed. It's. I only have it on my computer. The final report. But the built environment. So the built environment category 3 was compact and complete communities. That was 20 available points. My guess is we got most of those points. But the way each of these is structured is a purpose. There's an evaluation measure, which is the sort of assessment, and then community level outcomes. That talk about what things do we want in terms of outcomes. But just to read what the purpose is and to see if it applies to Reading, concentrate development in compact, human-scaled, walkable centers and neighborhoods that connect to transit, offer diverse uses and services, and provide housing options for families of all income levels. Well,
okay, and I can give you an example where I live. I only have to walk a city block to be able to get to a bus.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So it's very easy transit for me, and then it actually takes less time for me to take the bus in once I get it, and I can get done with work in 10 or 15 minutes, have a bus to get me home.
Yeah, and they come back, every 20 minutes, I think. Well, I live a half a block from a bus stop.
Uh-huh.
I have to confess I don't take the bus.
Because you're riding your bike.
Because I'm riding my bike. When I have to go downtown, I make a point to walk if I have a meeting. When I was in City Hall on a regular basis, I walked to every one of those meetings.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on a committee at the Goggle Works, and when I have the time and the weather's okay, I'll walk to those meetings. And that's part of my personal health, not only the community health.
Right.
So we can... We don't have to linger on that.
Okay.
So then there's directions on what. So let's see. Let's pick another one. Housing affordability. Well, why does that matter? Well, let's see what it says here. How is our time? We've got about 20 minutes.
Yeah, we're doing good.
The purpose: construct, preserve, and maintain an adequate and diverse supply of location efficient and affordable housing options for all residents. Well. Either by by design or by economic devolution, we do have affordable housing in Reading.
We have a lot of housing stock because we were a factory town, and we provided the row homes and stuff, provided housing. Yeah. You could tell there was sort of like a class system of where the workers lived, where some of the people that were probably the business owners lived. They were all different kind of housing, and then the more elegant housing on the periphery of the city.
Yeah.
And so we have all this housing stock. That has led probably because we don't have a good national housing program. It probably led to the people that needed affordable housing to come to live in the city because they were poor and they could find affordable housing. But in the same breath, people can now afford to buy these homes.
Right.
What I've started to see happening now is more people are investing and fixing up the single family row homes.
I'm glad to hear that. What has been learned from countless studies, and it's informed something called the Congress for New Urbanism that does new town design, is that a diversity of housing types that provide for a range of income levels is what makes for a strong, healthy, sustainable community.
Right.
And one of the things that the new urbanists in their communities, they design the more affordable, modest housing is at the core, and then as you go out a certain distance, the houses get larger mm-hmm. and more expensive. The other thing that they do where it's a denser kind of design, and in fact there are parts, I mean it's gone out the window in New York and Manhattan because nothing's affordable, but the more opulent mansion kind of upper income kind of housing was on the avenues in different parts of the city, and the more modest housing was on the cross streets. So within the same block, you'd get smaller scale, smaller housing, kind of, more affordable, and the more expensive housing on the main avenues in different parts of the city. And they were developed that way by design. And that's so people, if somebody had servants, they could live around the block. But it provided for that mixture of income level where, whereas now the extreme is a place like San Francisco where, someone who, a janitor in a building must have to commute an hour and a half because
there's no affordable housing
in the right. city.
What we see in Reading, and I think it's an example, for instance, Mineral Spring Road, which was some of the more elegant housing, at this point a lot of it's been converted into multifamily or apartments. But that was, one of the boulevards. And then you had where I'm living on the hilly streets in East Reading, where we're a lot of the workers. You can see the design of the houses was for, single families. Unfortunately, and we've tried to move away the deconversion now, is to look at all the row homes that were converted into two-family apartments and see, that, because the buildings really can't handle the stress of having that many people live in them.
Well, that was one of the positive things that happened. I don't know which administration it happened and who was on council at the time, but we won't give credit to any individuals, was putting in place the ordinance that really enforced the zoning ordinance and that said you could not convert single-family homes without going through a zoning process. And that, I think, has I see in the paper each month that there are, multiple applications for people wanting to convert a single family home into multi-units. Now I know some of that is still being done illegally, but not to the extent that it was.
No, I think when I got on council, that was really one of the problems that really hit us, and we worked on those ordinances. But and I'm just seeing it from observation. I'm seeing more families now buying these single family homes and trying to remodel them. Something like the home I live in is 90 years old. Okay, so it's been upkept, but there's still a lot of work that continues to be needed to keep it, in the condition.
Yeah, tremendous.
But what you know about them, they had good bones. I mean, they were built very well.
My house was built in 1885. So
okay, you're a little older than I am then.
Yeah, it's strange. I'm getting to that. So that was built environment infill and redevelopment. That's really trying to fill in and maintain density and cohesiveness rather than half empty blocks and then spreading out. That's not a sustainable way to develop by any stretch. And the aspect of infill and redevelopment is let's take an example of both a good and bad example, but is it the dollar store at 6th and Bingaman? In a sense, in some way, the way it was developed physically is unfortunate, but in terms of the use of the site, it's a version of a department store. It's like a Woolworths occupying a kind of an important intersection where there's a lot of neighborhood around it. So, but it used an already developed site. So infrastructure was there. And so, water, sewer, electricity, gas, those things were there to service that land. Whereas if land is developed out in Burn Township, for the most part, all those have to be brought to the site. So from a sustainability standpoint, all of the disruption and the resources that go into bringing services to an undeveloped site are not good for the environment. Whereas if you're developing an already developed site, now some people complain because in the city there's certain challenges because of the congestion and and what's going on around it and the approval process. But from the standpoint of the environment and what's good for a community overall, it's definitely better to do that. Another category, well, you need to spend time on it, is public spaces. That's part of the built environment. That's a very important part of what makes a community healthy, is having public spaces for lots of reasons.
And Reading has an incredible amount of public spaces.
Yeah, we have great parks that are, you know, are being maintained fairly well.
We're getting better at that, by the way. I want to say that within the last couple of years, I've noticed a lot of investment made in just keeping our parks clean and well kept. We still need a lot of partners, but it's, you know, moving in the right direction.
Yeah, I've noticed that. So maybe I should just choose a couple of categories from each one of these.
Yeah, we have a few more minutes left, so.
Climate and energy. You know, I mean, that's, in some ways, it's self-explanatory. One of the categories is resource-efficient buildings, and we already talked about the LEED buildings. Mm-hmm. And it's very important, either with new buildings or retrofitting of existing buildings, to reduce the use of resources. And every structure has that opportunity, as I started to say before. Homeowners, a single-family house, you can do all kinds of things to reduce use of gas or oil for heating, for cooling, by putting in storm windows. You don't need to replace windows. You can put in storm windows. A lot of these homes, even my home, built in 1885, it's got the windows that were on the place in 1986 when we bought it. And I don't know when those windows were installed. They may be original. We just put storm windows. They're just as effective as a modern double pane window. There's no need to rip them out and put in vinyl windows. Waste minimization. Well, we have a great curbside recycling plan in the city. Mm-hmm. I'm sure that gave us a lot of points. We can recycle pretty much everything except styrofoam, and it works.
We're actually going to be changing the recycling containers to make them more user friendly, so that they're going to have lids on them now.
We have lids,
but different kind of lid, the hinge lids, so the lids don't get thrown off and end up disappearing.
Okay,
so there'll be hinge lids, and I think they're going to have wheels on them to make them easier to use. The only thing now that I'm not satisfied with, but I understand we evolved into single stream rather than separating, I wasn't quite pleased with that, but
yeah, I don't know how that happened. It certainly makes it easier on our end, but we separated our stuff.
Yeah, I still separated, even though it was both just a habit I got into. So yeah, whatever. Yeah. But we want to make it so that for our seniors, they're able to get recycling containers in and out. So, I think the administration at this point is coming forward with councils with some good recommendations, and our trash collection system has been improving over the years too.
Yeah, no. I say it's slowly becoming a public system.
Yeah, it will be a public system just by default.
A comprehensive system, yeah. I think more education about recycling would probably be good. There hasn't been a lot about that in terms of, public PR, getting people to think more about recycling, because you can recycle an awful lot of stuff. You can reduce your waste stream to a very, very small amount if you're diligent about recycling. Economy and jobs, business retention and development is one of the categories. Quality jobs, living wages, that's something we talked a lot about when we were putting this together. Targeted industry development and workforce readiness. I mean, those are self-explanatory.
Right.
There's a certain amount of good things that have been done in each one of those categories, and certainly we can improve on that. Education, arts, and the community. That's, you know, the first category is arts and culture. Well, it came up. When you started digging into the community, it was very strong. There's both institutions and then volunteer organizations that cover so many bases in terms of the arts in Reading. It's really, I think culturally we're a very rich community in terms of that aspect of things, and I think we did really well in that. And another subcategory scoring element was community cohesion, and we could talk about what that means, but that we could one can understand how that can contribute to sustainability, because it plays out positive in so many different dimensions. Educational opportunity and attainment. Historic preservation, I already talked about that a little bit. And then social and cultural diversity. Well,
we're about as diverse as we can be.
and it's part of what makes this a great place to be, I think. Equity and empowerment, well, that's civic engagement, civil and human rights, environmental justice, equitable services and access, human services, poverty prevention and alleviation. And then health and safety, active living, that, you know, I don't know that we need to define that any further. Community health and a health system, emergency prevention response, food access and nutrition. All of those have been, there have been a lot of initiatives in each of those fronts, and there's continuing initiatives. You know, the health clinics are part of that. The Reading Health System, their efforts to reach out into the community. I know they have they operate a clinic at Opportunity House, and I think maybe a couple other places in the city. Indoor air quality, we talked about that earlier on. Natural and human hazards. That's probably a topic for another show. Safe communities. Well, that's, you know, we know what that is, although it's more broadly defined than just crime prevention.
Right.
And then natural systems, green infrastructure, invasive species, natural resource protection, outdoor air quality, water in the environment, and then working lands. I think, well, how much, we only have a couple minutes. You probably want to do some wrap up.
Right, right. And I'm going to give an example of something that's going to happen that really fits into this.
Sure.
Okay, we know that we have a problem with people illegally dumping, okay? And they tend to use the areas where they feel they're not going to be observed as much.
Uh-huh.
And we especially, up around the area of the pagoda, notice that people dump things over the side of the mountain. Okay, so we felt, I'm a member of the Pagoda Foundation, and talking with the people from Pagoda Skyline and Mount Penn Preserve, coming up on February 2nd is Groundhog Day. Okay, now one thing that we decided to do, and it's always included in our Groundhog Day celebration up at the Pagoda, is that we have Patty Pagoda, our mascot, our groundhog, and she doesn't like the fact that her little nest is constantly being trashed by people throwing things down the mountain. So we're teaming up now with the Crime Alert mascot, and on Groundhog Day, going to initiate an awareness campaign about how we can keep our pagoda or our mountainside, how to keep it healthy for Patty Pagoda, so she has a safe place to live. And not acknowledging that there are a lot of other things besides humans that live on the mountain, and that we're really infringing on their habitat by trashing the side of the mountain. So that's just the one thing about making the awareness, not only littering occurring in the city, but littering occurring in all around our natural resources.
Yeah.
So we just have to keep the momentum up. There's all different opportunities, and it has to be a shared responsibility of the community. So we have to outreach to our young people, to our seniors, and have everyone engaged in all being on the same page about how we sustain our community by our daily actions. And I think for me, that's the most important point. I'm starting to walk more. It's good for my health. It's good for the environment. And to be able to model that for other people so that everyone can be part of the solution.
It's actually fun, too, because you see the community that you live in when you walk. You kind of, or you encounter people, but you notice things that are happening, which it just makes it, you know, we both choose to live in the city because we like those aspects of it.
Yeah, I would never want to live out in the suburbs and have to be dependent on my car to get everywhere I go. So I think the next step, and it's going to happen, and I know I spoke with my fellow counselors, is we're going to be looking at that STAR program and how to get recertified again. So I hope, Bill, you'll stay involved with that, as well as the other folks that are, and go through the whole process. Work with the city administration, who all our other partners are, and say that we all are going to be a part of, not only because we want the designation, but because we want to do the things that are right for our community, and however that might be. So I'm glad we had a chance to inform folks about the whole STAR process and sustainability, but it's just the beginning of the dialogue.
You know, if we do have a second, I just want to mention quickly what company we're in. There is only, at the time this was published in 2014, there was only one five-star community, and that was Northampton, Massachusetts. And if anybody knows about Northampton or has ever been there, it's a spectacular place. It's very close to the University of Massachusetts, and Amherst is nearby, and Smith College is there.
But
four-star communities are Austin, Texas; Davenport, Iowa; Tacoma, Washington; Tucson, Arizona. I mean, those are cities that we hear about all the time. So anyway,
yep,
we're time to go.
Time to go. I think they're saying goodbye, but we'll see you soon, yep. And we'll keep the dialogue going. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Marcia.